Good morning, participants. I hope you are all able to see me and hear me. If anyone has audio or video problem, please raise your hand before we start today's session. So apparently no problem with anyone, so you can start today's session. Today we'll be discussing IAS 17, Accounting Standard 17. So IAS 17 basically prescribes the accounting treatment for lease in the financial statement of the lessees and the lessors. How a lease will be accounted for in the books of the lessee and the lessor, that is prescribed through International Accounting Standard 17. So we'll try to define and categorize a lease. First we'll try to define and categorize a lease into an operating lease and a financing lease. So we'll first discuss what is a lease, and there are two types of lease. One is called operating lease, the other is called financing lease. So how do you decide whether a lease is operating or a financing lease, because the accounting treatments will be different in the two cases. So we'll also try to understand the accounting treatment for the operating lease as well as the financing lease. We'll also talk about the special transactions of sale and leaseback and identify the difference between IFRS and US GAAP so far as accounting treatment for lease is concerned. We'll define lease. Just a moment, wait a little, we'll come to the definition of lease. Okay. So lease is an agreement between a lessor and a lessee which conveys or gives the lessee, which conveys to or gives the lessee the right to use an asset for a specified period of time in return for a payment of a series of payments. So now you tell me whether lease is equal to rent. So this is an agreement between a lessor and a lessee whereby the lessee gets the right to use an asset for a specified period of time in return for a payment or a series of payments to be made to the lessor. So it's an agreement between the lessor and the lessee. The lessee gets the right by virtue of that agreement to use a specified asset or a particular asset for a specified period of time, and for that he has to either make a payment or a series of payments to the lessor. That is what is lease. That is how lease is defined. So a lease transaction is a perfect example of the principle substance over form. So you do not really look into the form of the agreement, legal form of the agreement. The economic substance of the transaction determines the treatment and not just its legal form for a true and fair view of the financial statements. So whenever you look at a lease, you have to look at the economic substance of the transaction rather than the legal form of the transaction. The definition of a lease also includes those contracts for hire of an asset that contains provisions for the hirer to acquire title to the asset upon fulfillment of agreed conditions. These are sometimes called hire purchase contracts. So the definition of lease also includes hire purchase contracts where the hirer acquires title to the asset upon fulfillment of agreed conditions. Lease, as I mentioned, that there are two types of lease: operating lease and financing lease. So the classification of leases, whether it is a lease is an operating lease or a financing lease, has to be made at the inception of the lease. When the lease starts, you have to identify whether this is an operating lease or a financing lease. The inception of lease is the earlier of the agreement date and the date of commitment by the parties to the terms. So you have to keep in mind a few things about lease. It's an agreement, number one, contract between two parties. One party is called the lessor, the other party is called the lessee. By virtue of this contract, lessee gets the right to use its asset over a specified period of time, and for that the lessee has to pay, make a payment or a series of payments to the lessee. And very importantly, we don't look into the legal form of the agreement. More than that, we look into the economic substance of the agreement to understand whether it's an operating lease or a financing lease. This classification of a lease either into an operating lease or a financing lease should be made from the beginning of the lease transaction, from the inception of the lease transaction, because the accounting treatment would be different for the two kinds of leases. So let's look into what we really mean by operating lease and financing lease. We'll try to explain now. So we look at the classification, the two kinds of classifications of lease or lease classifications. Depending on whether the substance of a lease and depending on whether the lease substantially transfer all the risk and rewards related to the ownership of the leased asset to the lessee, there are two types of lease. So basically we have to look at whether the agreement transfers all the risk and rewards of ownership from the lessor to the lessee or not. So we have to look at the economic substance of the agreement. We have to also verify or understand whether the risk and rewards of ownership is passed on from the lessor to the lessee or not. Based on that, there are two types of lessee, in the two types of leases. If the risk and rewards of ownership are transferred to the lessee, then we call it a finance lease. See, risk and reverse of ownership doesn't mean the title has to be passed on to the lessee. The risk and reverse of ownership, if it is transferred to the lessee, it's a finance lease. If the transfer doesn't take place, then it's an operating lease. In case of a finance lease, the lessor will recognize the asset when the lease takes over the lease. From the beginning of the lease, the lessor will recognize the asset from its books, and the lessee will recognize the asset in its book. So the asset will be recognized in the lessor's book and recognized in the lessee's book in case of finances. Whatever lease payments are received by the lessor, that will have two components, principal and interest. So lease receipts will have two components, principal plus interest, whereas lease payments made by the lessee will have two components, principal plus interest. In case of an operating lease, where the risk and rewards of ownership do not get transferred to the lessee, the lessor will continue to recognize the asset in its books, and lease receipts will be treated as income only, as revenue income. And lessee will, whatever payments are made by the lessee, lease payments will be treated as an expense in the lessee's book as a revenue expense. So the classification of a lease as either a finance lease or an operating lease is critical, as significantly different accounting treatments are required for different types of lease. The classification is based on the extent to which risks and rewards of ownership of the leased asset are transferred to the lessee or remain with the lessor. Risk can include technological obsolescence, It can include loss from idle capacity. It can include variations in return. And reverse can include rights to sell the asset and gain from a capital value. You will see examples afterwards. Let's first try to understand the differences or the points first. Examples will be there, plenty of examples will come. Okay, we'll see examples, we'll see certain examples where we have to identify whether the lease is a finance lease or operating lease. We have to do that. That will come in the due time. Okay, so reverse can include rights to sell the asset and gain from its capital value. So please understand this point, because this points will be used when you have to categorize a lease into operating lease or a finance lease. So then we'll see the examples. A lease is classified as a finance lease if it substantially transfers all the risk and rewards of ownership to the lessee. If it doesn't, then it's an operating lease. When classifying a lease, it is important to recognize the substance of the agreement rather than its legal form. So the economic substance of the agreement should be looked into in classifying a lease as an operating lease or a finance lease. The commercial reality is important. So conditions in the lease may indicate that an entity has only a limited exposure to the risk and benefits of the leased assets. However, the substance of the agreement may indicate otherwise. So we have to sometimes go beyond the legal form and try to understand the substance of the agreement, whether the risk and benefits of the leased assets gets passed on to the lessee or not. Derecognized asset means it will not be shown in the books of the lessor anymore. Derecognized means it will not be reflected as an asset in the books of the lessor. See, recognition, derecognition, we have been saying number of times. Recognition and derecognition means whether your books of account shows that asset or not. When you want to reflect an asset in your books of account and recognize the asset, it gets reflected, the value of the asset will be reflected in your books of accounts, in your statement of financial position or balance sheet. When you derecognize it, it will not be reflected in the balance sheet. That is recognition or derecognition. Is that clear, Hemant? Is the point clear? Whenever you use the word recognize, derecognize, we are talking about whether the asset is reflected in the balance sheet of the entity or not, in the statement of financial position of the entity or not. That is what is meant by recognition or derecognition. Is that clear? So tell me when you are finished with this slide. We'll definitely see some examples of operating lease and finance lease. Try to understand the points which can help us to understand whether a lease is operating or a finance lease. So Hemant, are you done with this slide or not? Tell me when you are done with this slide. Okay, thank you. So now going to finance lease or capital lease. Another name for finance lease is capital lease. That's an alternative name for finance lease. Somewhere you may come across the word capital lease. So this is same as finance lease. A lease which substantially transfers all the risk and rewards related to the ownership of a leased asset to the lessee is termed as a finance or capital lease. In a financial capital lease, the title of the asset may or may not be transferred eventually. You don't think that always in case of a finance lease, the title of the asset will be passed on to the lessee. Risk and reverse of ownership of the asset is transferred substantially to the lessee, from the lessor to the lessee. But it doesn't necessarily mean in a finance lease or capital lease, the title of the asset will be passed on to the lessee. It may be passed on to the lessee eventually, or it may not be passed on. Of course, one of the tests, one of the way of knowing whether it's finance lease is to see whether the title of the asset gets passed on to the lessee or not. That is a test. That is one of the determining points. But that may not happen always. Sometimes there can be finance lease where the title to the asset will not be transferred eventually to the lessee. So that is not a that is not a something which is conclusive always. So some of the indicators of finance lease are, how do you understand whether a lease is a finance lease or not? Some of the indicators. The ownership is transferred to the lessee at the end of the lease term. This is one indicator. If the agreement, you look at this agreement, it says that the ownership of the asset will be transferred to the lessee at the end of the lease term. It indicates that this could be a finance lease. But as I told you, it is not necessary that in all cases of finance lease, the ownership will get transferred to the lessee at the end of the lease term. But if it is there, if the agreement says that the ownership of the asset, or title to the asset, will be transferred to the lessee at the end of the lease term, that indicates to a finance lease. But that condition may not apply to, there can be finance lease without, even without this particular clause in the lease agreement. Second indicator could be the lessee has an option to purchase the asset at a bargain price, and it is likely at the inception that the option will be exercised. So the lease term says, or the terms of the lease agreement says, the lessee will have an option to purchase the asset at a bargain price. That means at a very fair price practically, at the end of the lease term, and it appears likely that from the inception it appears that this option is going to be exercised by the lessee. Third indicator could be the lease term is for the majority of the economic life of an asset. So the lease term is for, the agreement is, will cover the majority of the economic life of the asset. That is the third indicator. Fourth indicator is, at the inception of the lease, the value of the minimum lease payments is greater than or equal to substantially all of the fair value of the leased asset. This could be the fourth indicator. That means the value of the minimum lease payments to be made by the lessee is greater than or equal to substantially all of the fair value of the leased asset. As we told earlier, that the commercial terms basically determine the substance of the agreement. We have to look at the commercial terms, and that really determines the substance or economic substance of an agreement. Although legal terms may or may not, sometimes legal terms may or may not, but substance or economic substance of the agreement is determined normally by the commercial terms. So the various situations we have discussed here, In each of the situations we have discussed here, may individually or in combination with other situations may indicate that substance would usually lead to a lease being a finance lease. That the economic substance will lead us to understand whether it is a finance lease or not. Emphasis must be placed on the risk that the lessor retains more than the benefits of ownership of the asset. To understand whether a lease is a finance lease, we have to look at the risk that the lessor actually retains after the lease, after he leases the asset. Second and third point not clear. Okay, second point is, the lessee has an option So the lease says the lease is for, so let's say lease is for 10 years. And at the end of the 10 years, at a throwaway price, the lessee can purchase the asset. After using the asset for 10 years, under the lease term, the lessee can purchase the asset, because lease is not a purchase. He can outright purchase of the asset by paying a bargain price or a throwaway price. Supposing the asset cost, let's say 5 crores, and after using it for 10 years, the lessee has an option, he can buy the asset for 5 lakhs. And lessee has the option, he can use the option, he may not use the option. So at a bargain price, he can buy the asset at the end of the lease term. This is not clear? Hemant? I'm giving an example to you. The leased asset has a value of 5 crores. The lessee will use it for 10 years, and at the end of 10 years, after making all the lease payments for 10 years, he has the option to buy it at 5 lakhs, which is a throwaway price compared to the original value of the asset. Third point is the lease term is for the majority of the economic life of an asset. The economic life of the asset is 15 years. The lease term is for 12 years. So it is for the majority of the economic life of the asset. The asset has an economic life of maximum, say, 15 years. And the lease has been taken for a period of 12 years. Is that point clear? This is what it means. So we have to understand that whether risk and reverse of ownership has been passed on to the lessee or not, we will rather put the emphasis on the risk of ownership. Question is whether the risk of ownership is retained by the lessor or not. More than the benefits of ownership of the asset, we will look at whether the risk of ownership of the asset is retained by the lessor or not. If the risk of ownership of the asset is substantially transferred to the lessee, then it indicates to a finance lease. If there is very little risk of ownership retained by the lessor, then the agreement will be treated as a finance lease. But if the lessor suffers the risk associated with the movement in the market price of the asset or the use of the asset, then usually the lease is an operating lease. So although we say the words risk and reverse of ownership, we rather put focus to understand whether the lease is operating or a finance lease. Our focus is more on the risk of ownership, whether they are going to be retained by the lessor or passed on to the lessee. Okay, so more than the benefits of ownership, we look at the risk of ownership, whether they get transferred from the lessor to the lessee substantially or not. So these are the four important indicators of finance lease. One is ownership is transferred to the lessee at the end of lease term, or the lessee has an option to purchase the leased asset at a bargain price, and it is likely at the inception this option is to be exercised. The lease term is for the majority of the economic life of an asset is another indicator, and at the inception of the lease, the value of the minimum lease payments is greater than or equal to substantially all of the fair value of the leased asset. There could be other indicators also. What are the other indicators? We have talked about four indicators which alone individually or in combination may point or may determine that a lease is a finance lease. So what are the other indicators? The leased assets are of such a specialized nature that only the lessee can use them without major modifications being made. So it's a very specialized kind of an asset. Nobody else can use it except the lessee. Without major modifications, nobody else can use the asset except the lessee. There are certain types of assets which are very specialized in nature and can be used by only one user. without major modifications and other user may not be able to use it. So if the asset is of such a specialized nature that only the lessee can use them without major modifications being made, this could be another indicator that this is a finance lease. Another indicator could be the lessee bears the lessor's losses if the lessee cancels the lease. If lessee cancels the agreement, cancels the lease at any point of time, whatever losses are to be suffered by the lessor will be borne by the lessee. This is another indicator. So that's why we are looking at the commercial terms. Another indicator could be the lessee absorbs the gain or losses from fluctuations in the fair value of the residual value of the asset. Whatever fluctuations can take place in the fair value of the residual value of the asset, the gain or loss from that will be absorbed by the lessee. And another indicator could be the lessee may extend the lease for a secondary period at a rent substantially below the market rent. This is called bargain renewal option. The commercial term says the lessee may extend the lease for a secondary period at a rent which is substantially below the market rent. After the lease term expires, the lessee has an option to extend the lease period, but this time he will pay a rent which is much below the market rent for such leased asset. So these are the various indicators, because as I'm telling you over and again, don't go into the legal form of the agreement, but go into the economic substance of the commercial terms of the agreement to understand whether a lease is an operating or a finance lease. So these are the indicators in the commercial terms. You will come across this kind of commercial terms. Whether in the lease agreement it is stated as operating as a finance lease, if we come across these indicators, it will be determined that this is a finance lease, whatever the legal form may say. So here, the economic substance will always be more important than the legal form of the lease. Now I have introduced a word, minimum lease payments. Just now one of the indicators, the fourth indicator here in slide number 5 of 28. There's a mention of something called minimum lease payments. So what does minimum lease payments means? So let's look at what is meant by minimum lease payments. Minimum lease payments is the payment done over the lease term that a lessee is a payment over the lease terms that a lessee is or can be required to make. So it is a payment over the lease term that a lessee is required to make or can make or can be required to make. So it can include the guaranteed residual value, it can include the purchase option at the end of the lease terms, it can include the lease payment under bargain renewal option. So minimum lease payments can include guaranteed residual value, it can include the purchase option, it can include the lease payments under the bargain renewal option. This is basically the payments over the lease term that are required to be made. For a lessee, this includes any amounts guaranteed to be paid. For a lessor, this includes any residual value guaranteed to the lessee. Whatever guaranteed amount is guaranteed to the lessor, that will be included in the minimum lease payments. So for a lessee, this will include any amounts which is guaranteed to be paid to the lessor. For the lessor also, this includes any residual value guaranteed to the lessor. But it excludes what is not included in the minimum lease payments are cost for services, taxes to be paid is paid by and reimbursed to the lessor, and contingent rent if any. So minimum lease payments includes the guaranteed payments to the lessor, but it excludes the cost for services. Taxes to be paid if paid and reimbursed to the lessor, and contingent rent if any. Contingent rent is a rent which is to be paid under certain condition. If some certain conditions are met, then that rent will be paid. It is over and above the normal rent. If some conditions are fulfilled, only that is contingent upon those conditions, only the rent, additional rent can be paid. That is called contingent rent. So contingent may or may not be paid because the condition, if the conditions are not fulfilled, that will not be paid. Supposing the condition is that the lessee has a right to use the asset for a certain number of hours every day, it's a fixed number of hours. If it is used for more hours than that agreed upon, the lessee has to pay some additional rent. That is called contingent rent. I'm just giving an example of contingent rent. Supposing the lease term says that the lessee will make payment of the normal lease payments based on a certain level of usage of the asset. Maybe 12 hours he can use the asset. For extra use of the asset, he has to pay extra rent. That is contingent. Contingent rent is the rent payable on fulfillment of certain conditions. Okay, somebody wanted the earlier slide, so I am keeping it here. So, Hemant, are you finished with the earlier slide? Then I move to the slide number 8. So, what it includes and what it excludes? So minimum lease payments will include a guaranteed payment to the lessor, but excludes the cost of service, taxes, and contingent rent. What is the question? Title of the No, not necessary. As I told you earlier very clearly, if the title of the asset passes on to the lessee at the end of lease term, it's an indicator that this is a finance lease. Okay, if the title of the asset gets automatically passed on to the lessee at the end of lease term, it indicates to a finance lease. But in all finance lease, you may not see this condition. There can be finance lease where the title of the asset may not be passed on to the lessee at the end of the lease term automatically. There can be a bargain purchase option, there can be a bargain renewal option, there can be some other things. So it is not necessary that in all finance lease, don't get stuck with the idea that in all finance lease the title of the asset will get automatically transferred to the lessee at the end of lease term. Yes. If that condition is there, as part of the lease agreement, if it is a part of the commercial terms, it indicates to a finance lease. But even without that condition or that terms in the commercial terms in the lease agreement, still a lease can be a finance lease. That's my point. So how a non-current asset and the finance lease liability are recorded by the lessee? As I told you, in a finance lease, the asset will be recognized in the lessor's book and get recognized in the lessee's book. In case of a finance lease, the asset which has been leased will be recognized in the lessor's book and will be recognized by the lessee in his books of accounts. So when it is recognized in the books of account of the lessee, it is a non-current asset. And there will be a corresponding liability which is called finance lease liability. Because asset must be matched by a liability. So if you are recognizing that leased asset in the lessee's book as a non-current asset, there should be a liability corresponding to that is called finance lease liability. So this will be recorded, a non-current asset and the finance lease liability will be recorded by the lessee at the level of the present value of the amounts guaranteed by the lessee, that is minimum lease payments, or the fair value of the asset. So at the minimum of these two, whichever is there. So if you recognize that non-current asset which has been leased to the lessee under a finance lease, lessee will pass accounting entries. But that non-current asset will be recognized at the lower of these two values, that is the present value of the amounts guaranteed by the lessee, that is minimum lease payments, the present value of the minimum lease payments, and the fair value of the asset or cash price of the asset. The fair value of the asset could be the cash price of the asset if you purchase it from the supplier or the manufacturer. The lessee will pay the total of the capital borrowed and associated finance charge. So the liability of the lessee will be the, basically lessee is going to pay the total of the capital borrowed and the associated finance charge. So interest is basically minimum lease payments minus liability recorded. So interest component will be basically, because lessee what he pays as lease payments comprises of two parts. One is the principal, the other is the interest. So finance lease is nothing but a financing arrangement, nothing other than that. Instead of taking a loan for purchase of an asset, an entity can acquire the asset under a finance lease, which is nothing but a financing agreement with the lessor. So what the lessee pays to the lessor is, as lease payments are nothing but means towards, goes through the principal cost of the asset, principal plus interest. So the lessee will pay the total of the capital borrowed and associated finance charge. So interest is nothing but minimum lease payments minus the liability recorded in the lessee's books. Interest should be allocated to P&L, to profit and loss account, so as to give a constant periodic rate of charge on the outstanding balance. So interest should be basically allocated to profit and loss account every year or every accounting period, so as to give a constant periodic rate of charge on the outstanding balance. If there is no reasonable certainty that the lessee will obtain ownership by the end of the lease term, then lessee should depreciate the asset over the shorter of the lease term or the useful life. So these are the various guidelines under IS 17 regarding finance lease, accounting treatments of finance lease in lessee's books. Number one, it will be the finance lease will be second cycle test is already over. So Sukhdeep Singh, second cycle test was due last week, as I remember, on Thursday. So, this is the guidelines for accounting treatment of finance lease in the lessee's book. So, lessee will recognize the leased asset, which is a non-current asset. So, it will recognize a non-current asset in the books of the lessee, and there will be corresponding finance lease liability also will be recorded in the lessee's books. And this will be done at the value, at what value it will be, what will be the measurement? The measurement of this asset and liability will be the lower of the present value of the amounts guaranteed by minimum, by the lessee, that is minimum lease payments, or the fair value of the asset, for example, the cash price of the asset. Over the period of the lease, lessee actually pays the capital borrowed and associated finance charge, so the interest is nothing but minimum lease payments minus the liability recorded. The difference, because we are actually taking the present value of the minimum lease payments. So minimum lease payments minus liability recorded reflects the interest payment made by the lessee to the lessor on the capital borrowed. And this interest should be allocated to P&L account every accounting period, so as to give a constant periodic rate of charge on the outstanding balance. If there is no reasonable certainty as to whether lessee will acquire the ownership by the end of the lease term, then it will depreciate the asset over the shorter of the lease term and the useful life of the asset. So whichever is shorter. So at the commencement of the lease term, a lessee shall recognize an asset and a liability at the fair value of the leased asset, or if lower, at the present value of the minimum lease payments. The appropriate discount rate In the present value calculation, when you are calculating present value, you are using a discount rate. That should be the rate implicit in the finance lease. So the impact of this treatment is to reflect the economic sustenance of the transaction. The lessee has acquired an asset for the substantial part of its useful life and expects to obtain substantially all the benefits from its use. In other words, the lease arrangement is merely a financing vehicle for the acquisition of an asset. So in a finance lease, the lease arrangement is nothing but a financing vehicle for acquisition of the asset. Subsequent to the initial recognition, as I told you, the present value of the amount guaranteed by the lessee or the fair value of the asset, whichever is there. Subsequent to the initial recognition, that is when the initial recognition takes place at the inception of the lease. Subsequent to initial recognition, at the end of each accounting period, the lease payments are apportioned between the repayment of the outstanding liability and the finance charge, so as to reflect a constant periodic rate of interest on the liability. Let's look at the lessee's statement of financial position or balance sheet. In the lessee's statement of financial position or balance sheet at the inception of the lease, supposing the lessee has taken on a lease a fixed assets. It could be a machinery, it could be a plant, it could be a ship, it could be an aircraft. Many of the airlines, what they do, instead of buying the aircraft, they take it on the acquire it on lease. Many of the airlines do it. So instead of buying the aircraft from the manufacturer of the airplane, they can take it on lease. They can take an aircraft on lease from Boeing or Airbus. Okay. So these are mostly the basically fixed assets. These are basically property, plant and equipment which are normally taken on lease. So in the lessee statement of financial position of fixed assets will be the leased asset at fair value or PV of the MLP. It will be shown as a fixed asset or non-current asset, and the initial recognition will be the fair value of the leased assets will be basically either the fair value of the leased assets or present value of the minimum lease payments, whichever is lower. Then every year you have to charge a depreciation as you charge on your fixed assets. So it will be reduced by the amount of depreciation which is charged every accounting year, and the depreciation will be charged basically in particular if there is no certainty as to the acquisition of the asset at the end of lease term, then the depreciation will be charged over the shorter of the two periods, that is lease term and the useful SOFP. You don't know what is SOFP. So you are taking GFS course for how many days now? You are not yet acquainted with these terms. SOFP is statement of financial position, which is commonly called balance sheet. Please get acquainted with these terms. It is statement of financial position, that is what is we call balance sheet. Is that clear or not clear? You are taking this course for, I don't know for how many sessions have taken place, but I still don't know the term SOFP. This has been covered a number of times. Okay. So in the balance sheet or lessee's statement of financial position, it will be shown as the fixed assets will be shown at the initial value, will be shown as the fair value of the leased assets or present value of the minimum lease payments, and every year depreciation will be charged. And on the liability side, this is on the asset side, liability side, lease payable at the fair value or PV of the MLP reduced by the principal value paid till date. In the lessee's balance sheet, that asset is derecognized. At the beginning of the lease, the asset will no longer appear in the lessee's balance sheet or statement of financial position. So lessee only will get lease receivables. It will be net investment in the lease. There will be a lease receivable appearing in the lessor's balance sheet, which is nothing but net investment in the lease. That will be MLP plus present value of unguaranteed residual value. So that will be reflected by the minimum lease payments plus present value of unguaranteed residual value. So it will be reflected as an asset, as it is receivable. Depreciation, any method can be used, straight line method can be used, written down value method can be used, that is a choice of the entity. Method charge to depreciation is a choice of the entity. Entity, that particular entity, one entity may choose to do it by straight line method, another entity may choose to do it by written down value method. So I cannot say which method will be charged to depreciation, that will depend on the entity which method they prefer to use. So the asset needs to be depreciated by the lessee over the expected useful life under the IS 16 using rates for similar assets. Only thing, the rates to be applied, depreciation rates for similar assets should be applied here. Okay, they cannot use a separate depreciation rate or different depreciation rate than what they are charging for similar assets. If there is no reasonable certainty that the ownership will transfer to the lessee at the end of the lease term, then the shorter of the lease term and the useful life should be used for charging depreciation. Okay. So for the accounting purpose, in the lessee's book, in the lessee's balance sheet, recognize the leased asset less depreciation, accumulated depreciation, and recognize the liability of an equivalent amount which is present value of the MLP. In the income statement, the finance expense in lease rentals will be shown in the income statement as an expense. The finance expense in the lease rentals, because lease rentals have got two components. One is the financing component, that is the interest component, other is the principal component. The interest component or the finance expense in the lease rentals will be charged to the profit and loss account. So far as the lessee's book is concerned. In the lessee's book of accounts, we recognize the leased asset and recognize the receivable, present value of the MLP. So one asset will be extinguished, the leased asset will be extinguished from the statement of financial position of the lessee, and another asset will be created in its place, that is the receivable or the present value of the MLP. In the balance sheet, as before the inception of the leased asset was appearing or recognized in the books of lessee. But once the asset is leased under a finance lease, we will no more recognize the leased asset as a fixed asset in the books of the lessee. It will be, rather will be changing it to a receivable, that is the present value of MLP. So instead of the fixed asset, will have a receivable or PV of the MLP appearing in the books of the lessee. And the finance income will be, in the lease rentals, will be taken as a revenue income, so it will be created to the income statement. So this is the accounting treatment in brief. This is the accounting treatment in brief in the books of the lessor and the lessee. What is the question from Subhash? Can lessee do modification in assets? If it is a finance lease, possibly yes, because the risk and rewards of ownership has been transferred to the lessee substantially, so he possibly can make some modification in the asset. Possibly. You have to look at the commercial terms again. There cannot be a blanket yes or no here. But if it is a finance lease, I think it is possible, because the risk and rewards of ownership have been substantially transferred to the lessee, but not in the case of an operating lease. Operating lease, that is, the lessee may not be able to do any modification to the leased asset unless permitted by the lessor. And so that is the point. So that much I can say. So operating lease is a lease other than anything other than a finance lease, we call it operating lease. If it is not a finance lease, by default it is operating lease. So operating lease is a lease other than the finance lease, that is a lease that doesn't transfer substantially all the risk and rewards related to the ownership of the leased asset. Like there are examples of operating lease, we'll see. Finance lease, of course, we'll see some more examples afterwards. Operating lease, some examples, IB Limited takes a truck on lease for a 7-year lease term. Now let's see. The conditions of the lease are: AB Limited takes a truck on lease for a 7-year lease term. Lease payments are $3,000 a year. Fair value of the truck is $38,000. That is, if you want to buy the truck from the market today, you have to pay $38,000. Unguaranteed residual value is $7,000. This is not guaranteed. Unguaranteed residual value is $7,000. Economic life is 15 years. Question is this an operating lease and why? This is an operating lease. Number one, lease term is not for the majority of economic life. The economic life is 15 years. The lease term is only for 7 years, less than half of the, even less than half of the economic life of the asset. This is point number one. Then present value of the minimum lease payments, unguaranteed residual value is not part of the lease payment. So if you take the present value of the minimum lease payment, that is 3,000 per year for 7 years, if you take the present value, it is not the substantial of the fair value of the leased asset. Fair value is 38,000. If you take the present value of a cash flow of 3,000 for next 7 years, it will come to something around, depending on the rate of discount you are applying, it will be less than 21,000, or it will be less than half of the, nearly half of the value of the fair value of the leased asset. So it is not substantial of the fair value of the leased asset. There is second indicator. No bargain option. No option for the lessee to purchase the truck at a throwaway price after 7 years. So no bargain option available. Ownership doesn't transfer at the end of the lease term. And leased asset is not a specialized asset. It's a truck. Anybody can use it. So leased asset is not a specialized kind of an asset. So all these things, if we look at, then it's, we cannot consider this as a finance lease. This is an operating lease. So operating lease, as I told you, any lease other than finance lease. So to understand whether a lease is operating or finance lease, we'll have to first see the indicators for finance lease, whether they apply here or not. If the indicators of finance lease do not apply, as in this case, as we have seen in this case, then we will consider it as an operating lease. Because here we see, number one, the lease period is for 7 years as against the economic life of 15 years of the truck. The minimum value of the lease payment, the present value market, present value of the the present value of the MLP, basically 3,000 per year for 7 years, is not substantial of the fair value of the leased assets. Number three is no bargain option available. Number four is ownership doesn't get transferred to the lessee at the end of the lease term. And number five is this asset is not a specialized asset. This asset is a very general kind of an asset. Anybody can use the truck without any modification. The truck can be used by anybody. So we cannot consider this as a finance lease. Since we cannot consider this as a finance lease, it would be treated as an operating lease. We'll have a short break here at this juncture, and then we'll continue with some more examples of operating lease and finance lease. Welcome back after break. But in the case of operating lease, the accounting treatment is different. In the lessee's book, balance sheet will show, reflect if there is any accrued or prepayment of lease payments, it will be reflected in the balance sheet. If there is lease payments is accrued but not yet paid, or if there is a prepayment of lease payments, it will be either shown as a current or non-current asset, depending on period for which it is accrued or period for which prepayment has been made. And in the income statement, profit and loss, the lease rentals will be shown as an expense on accrual basis. That is what will happen in the lessee's books. In the lessee's books, assets leased out less depreciation will be appearing in the lessee's book. The asset will be still reflected in the lessee's book. So the asset leased out less depreciation charge on the asset will be reflected in the statement of financial position or balance sheet. If there is an accrued or deferred lease payments, it will be categorized as current or non-current depending on the period for which it is accrued or deferred. In the income statement, the lease rentals will be recognized as an income in the profit and loss account on accrual basis, and depreciation on the leased assets will be charged as an expense. This is the accounting treatment for operating lease. Now regarding land and building, if it is a lease for land and building, how we treat it? Sometimes land and building itself can be leased. Land along with a building on that land can be leased. So how will you, what will be the accounting treatment for that? When a lease includes both land and building elements, then the minimum lease payments are allocated to land and building based on the relative fair values of the leasehold interest in the land and building element. So you have to allocate the minimum lease payments amongst land and building separately based on the relative fair values of the leasehold interest in the land and building element. A lease of land for several decades, sometimes lands are leased for 30 years, 40 years like that, may be classified as a finance lease even though the title may not pass to the lessee, where all the risk and rewards are passed to the lessee substantially and the present value of the residual value is considered negligible. So the lease payments are so high that the present value of the residual value is considered negligible. So in that case, a lease of land for several decades can be treated as a finance lease, although the title to the land may not pass on to the lessee at the end of the lease term. Now we'll talk about certain differences between IFRS and US GAAP so far as leasing is concerned. In IFRS, the term finance lease is used, whereas in US GAAP we will come across the term capital lease. The terminologies are different. In IFRS, International Financial Reporting Standards, finance lease, this terminology is used, whereas in US GAAP the same finance lease is called capital lease. So far as classification of finance or capital lease is concerned, US GAAP, IFRS doesn't provide any further classification of finance lease. There is only finance lease, no further sub-classification. But under US GAAP, capital lease is further classified into sales type, profit included, or direct finance lease. There are two kinds of classifications. We may not go into the details here, because we are basically covering only IFRS. Now regarding lease criteria, there are certain differences between IFRS and US GAAP. Under IFRS IS 17, the lease criteria are basically the leases for the majority of the remaining economic life, which we have already discussed. The net present value of the MLP is substantially all of the fair value of the lease property at the inception date. Under US GAAP, the lease term should be for at least 75% of the remaining economic life, at least. Whereas for under IFRS, it should be for the majority, that means more than 50% of the remaining economic life. Under US GAAP for capital lease, the lease term should be for at least 75% of the remaining economic life. And the NP of the MLP is 90% or more of the fair value of the lease property at the inception date. So the criteria, lease criteria are different under IFRS and US GAAP for us, finance lease or capital lease is concerned. Under US GAAP, if the beginning of the lease term falls within the last 25% net present value, it is not NEP, it is NPV. There is a typing mistake. NPV, net present value. Discounted present value. Under US GAAP, ASC 840, if the beginning of the lease term falls within the last 25% of the lease asset's remaining life, then these two criteria may not be used to determine capitalization. But this rule is not specified in IFRS. If the beginning of the lease term falls within the last 25% of the lease asset's remaining life, then the first two conditions that which you have seen earlier, that the lease term is for at least 75% of the economic life and the NPV of the MLP is 90% or more of the fair value of the lease property at the inception date, these two criteria may not apply. But there is no such rule in IFRS. Land and building is generally accounted as a single unit under US GAAP, unless land represents 25% or more of the total fair value of the lease property. But under IFRS, land and building should be divided into separate components with separate classification and accounting. So these are the points of difference between IFRS and US GAAP so far as finance lease or capital lease is concerned. Now there are four additional finance lease criteria under IFRS which are not available in the US GAAP. These are not specified in US GAAP. These four additional finance lease criteria are: the lease assets are of such a specialized nature that only the lessee can use them without major modifications being made. This is one criteria. There are three other criteria for finance lease under US GAAP. The lessee bears the lessor's losses if the lessee cancels the lease. That is the second additional criteria. The third additional criteria under IFRS is the lessee absorbs the gains or losses from fluctuations in the fair value of the residual value of the asset. And the fourth additional criteria for finance lease in case of IFRS is the lessee may extend the lease for a secondary period at a rate substantially below the market rent, which is called bargain renewal option. So these four additional criteria which are available under IFRS to determine whether a lease is a finance lease or not, these criteria are not available under US GAAP. So US GAAP principally has got mainly two criteria, that the lease period covers 75% or more of the economic life of the asset, and secondly, the NPV of the MLP is 90% or more of the fair value of the leased asset. So with this in mind, with this criteria in mind, we look at this particular lease, example of the lease, and try to determine whether it is should be considered a finance lease under IFRS and whether it should be considered a finance lease using US GAAP. So the example is something like this. An equipment was taken by the lessee on the following terms. So let's look at the example very carefully. These are the commercial terms of the lease agreement. So an equipment was taken by the lessee on the following terms. The lease term is 3 years. Annual lease payment is 2,500. The unguaranteed residual value is 3,950. This is unguaranteed. Unguaranteed residual value of the leased asset is 3,950. The lessee has an option to purchase at the end of the lease term at 4,000. The economic life of the leased asset is 5 years. The lessee will absorb any gains or losses in any fluctuations of the fair value of the residual value. The ownership is not transferred at the end of the lease term. So these are the commercial terms of the lease. So based on that, we have to use IFRS and US GAAP to see whether the lease is to be considered as a finance lease or an operating lease. The economic life of the leased asset is 5 years, the lease term is 3 years, annual lease payment is 2,500, unguaranteed residual value is 3,950, the lessee has an option to purchase the asset at the end of the lease term paying 4,000. The lessee will absorb any gains or losses in any fluctuation of the fair value of the residual value, and the ownership is not transferred at the end of the lease term. So now let's look at this problem and try to understand. There are a few more conditions which you will see, and then try to understand whether it should be treated as a operating lease or finance lease, applying the criteria under IFRS or under US GAAP. The lease may be extended at the discretion of the lessee at the end of the lease period at a substantially lower end than the market value of rent. Implicit interest rate is 6%. It should be implicit interest rate at 6% ought to be applied for the lease period, and this makes the PV of the MLP as 6,680. The present value of the minimum lease payments, as you remember, are 2,500 for next 3 years. Using the 6% discount rate, the present value of the minimum lease payments comes to 6,680. The fair value of the leased asset at inception is 10,000. The depreciation is charged on the asset by the straight line method. So our question is, problem is how it would be classified, how would the lease be classified under IFRS and US GAAP, and we have to show the accounting entries in both the cases in the lessee's books. Accounting treatment or entries in both the cases, if it is treated as an operating lease or it is a finance lease, in the books of the lessee. Okay. Now we'll look at the solution. So we use the US GAAP capitalization criteria and IFRS capitalization criteria. So US GAAP capitalization criteria, the ownership, if the ownership is transferred to the lessee by the end of the lease term, this is one criteria. IFRS capitalization criteria also same, whether the ownership is transferred to the lessee at the end of lease term. It is no. So under US GAAP and IFRS, since the ownership is not transferred to the lessee by the end of the lease term, which is one criteria, that is no under both US GAAP and IFRS because the ownership is not getting transferred. Next criteria, we apply the first criteria, we get a no. Okay. Does the lease contain a bargain purchase option? This criteria is available under US GAAP as well as IFRS. The answer is no, because unguaranteed residual value is 3950 or 51. The lessee can purchase the asset at the end of the lease term paying 4000, which is more than the unguaranteed residual value. So there is no bargain purchase option available to the lessee. He has to pay more than the unguaranteed residual value. So where is the bargain? If he is required to pay much less than the unguaranteed residual value, there will be a bargain purchase option. So it also, this criteria doesn't also work here. Fine. Third criteria, under US GAAP, lease term is equal to 75% or more of the estimated economic life of the lease property. Here the lease property has a 5-year economic life and the lease is for 3 years, that is 60%. So under US GAAP criteria, we get a no. But when you apply the IFRS capitalization criteria, the lease term is a major part of the estimated economic life of the lease property because the economic life is 5 years and the lease term is 3 years, which is 60%, more than 50%. So it is I'm sorry. Under US IFRS US GAAP also, that 60% will not be qualifying as the basically major part of the economic useful life. Although IFRS is silent on what percentage, but the major part of the economic useful life, 60% only considered also the major part. So it is no under both criteria. The present value of the MLP equals or exceeds 90% of the fair value of the leased property. This is under US GAAP. The present value of the MLP is 6,682, which is only 6,682, which is around 67% of the fair value, 10,000. So it is no, this criteria also gives us a no answer under US GAAP. Under IFRS capitalization criteria, the present value of the MLP is substantially all of the fair value of the leased property. Again, it is no, because 6,682 is only 67%, which is not to be considered a substantially fair value, substantially all of the fair value of the leased property. So using these four criteria, under US GAAP and IFRS capitalization criteria, we cannot yet decide whether it is a finance lease. So now let's look at the additional four criteria, which is available only under US GAAP. These are not available under US, but available under IFRS. What are those additional four criteria? The leased assets are of such a specialized nature that only the lessee can use them without major modifications being made. This criteria is not available under US GAAP, but it is available under IFRS, and the answer is still no. There is nothing in the commercial terms to indicate that the asset is of a highly specialized nature which can be used only by the lessee without major modifications. Which can be only used by the lessee and nobody else without major modifications. Second criteria, additional criteria available under the IFRS, which is not specified in the US GAAP, is the lessee bears the lessor's losses if the lessee cancels the lease. Again, the commercial terms don't indicate that the lessee will bear the lessor's losses if the lessee cancels the lease. So this criteria is not available under US GAAP, so we have said not applicable, but in the case of IFRS, when you apply the criteria, the answer is no. Then we come to the third additional criteria under IFRS, which is not specified in US GAAP, not available in US GAAP. That is, the lessee absorbs the gains or losses from fluctuations in the fair value of the residual value of the asset. As US GAAP doesn't have this criteria, so we have written here not applicable, but as per the list terms we have seen, the lessee absorbs the gains or losses from fluctuations in the fair value of the residual value of the asset, so it is yes. So under IFRS, this criteria is satisfied. And you look at the fourth additional criteria under IFRS, which is not specified, not available in the US GAAP, the lessee may extend the lease for a secondary period at a rent substantially below the market rent. Again, because this criteria is not available under US GAAP, so we have just in the column we have put not applicable, but under IFRS, yes, this condition is there. According to the terms of the lease, the lessee may extend the lease for a secondary period, that means beyond the 3 years, for a rent substantially below the market rent, so this criteria also applies under US GAAP. So two of the additional four criteria, we get a yes answer. It applies. So whereas under US GAAP, the lease will be treated as an operating lease, under IFRS, since two of the additional four criteria are met, we can consider it as a finance lease. So the treatment of the same lease under IFRS and US GAAP will be different. So under IFRS, we will treat it as a finance lease, but under US GAAP, we will treat it as a operating lease. So since we are treating it as an operating lease under US GAAP, what will be the accounting treatment in the lessee's book? Lessee pays 2,500 every year as lease rental. So in the lessee's book, operating lease expense equipment, there will be debit to the operating lease expense equipment. It's an expenditure, it's nominal, basically expenditure account. Revenue expenditure account and credit cash. So whenever lease payments are made, cash will be credited and operating lease expense equipment will be debited. But under IFRS, whenever the lease payment is made, 2,550, what is the total present value of the MLP? 6,680. That is the finance lease liability. So every year when 2500 is paid, first year when 2500 is paid, of this 2500, 6% is the discount rate we applied, that is the implicit interest rate. So 6% of 6,680 is 400. So the 2500, when the payment, first payment is made, 2100 will be the finance lease liability, towards the finance lease liability, the principal, and 400 is the interest. So when the 2500 payment is made, in the lessee's books of accounts, finance lease liability will credit finance lease liability account as current liability 2100, and finance lease liability non-current is 4580. Okay, so the finance lease liability recorded at the lower of the MLP, fixed value of the MLP, that is 6680, and fair value of the asset 10,000. So in lessee's book, this will be reflected as a liability, number one. So equipment will be shown at 6680, which is basically the lower of the fair value of the asset or present value of the MLP, which is 6680. On the liability side, we have finances liability current, that is payable within next 12 months, 2100, and remaining is non-current 4580. So that will be how it will be shown at the inception of the lease in the books of the lessee. When payment of the first year's lease rentals are made, so cash will be created 2500, finance lease liability current will be created with 2000, will be debited with 2100, and expense will be created with 400. So out of 2500, which will be created to cash, 2100 will be debited to finance lease liability, and interest expense will be debited to the extent of 400. That is not a credit, but it will be a debit. So the lease payment will be recorded, the related interest expense will be recorded in the lessee's book, and at the end of the year, depreciation will be charged on 6680 by straight line method. Any charge depreciation will be 1/3 of 6680. That is 2,226. So at the end of the year, equipment will credit by 2,226 amount of depreciation, and depreciation account will be debited with 2,226. So annual depreciation on the finance lease asset will be charged to P&L account. So this will be the accounting treatment of the finance lease in the books of accounts of the books of accounts of the lessee under the IFRS. See, basically, if you look at the finance lease, year one, the opening balance of the finance lease liability was 6,680. 6% interest on that is 400 for the first year. Annual payment is 2,500, this rental. So 2,100 is the, of which 400 is the interest component. So 2,100 will be basically reduce the finance lease liability to 4,580 end of first year. In the second year, now the finance lease liability is 4,580, interest at 6% will be 275 on that. Since this payment is 2,500, so the balance amount 2,355 will be reducing the finance lease liability. So the finance lease liability at the end of second year will be 2,355. I think there is a mistake in the calculation here, just a minute. Closing balance will be actually of the finances liability will be 2,500 minus 275, which is 2,225. So 4,580 will be reduced by 2,225. So the closing finances liability will be 2,355. In the third year, no, it is, calculation is right. On 2,355, 6% interest gives you 145. The balance will, 2,355 from the lease rental, will extinguish the finances liability. So at the end of the third year, the finances liability will be completely extinguished. So the 7,500 of lease payments made during the 3 years, 820 is the interest component and 6,600 is the principal component. Is that clear? Any question? So please ask it if you have any questions. If I have gone too fast, I can repeat the entire thing. But first thing we have to understand, looking at the terms of the lease, looking at the all the terms of the lease, we have to use the IFRS and US GAAP criteria to determine whether it is a finance lease or operating lease. So we have done that. We have looked at all the terms and commercial terms or terms and conditions of the lease agreement and use the criteria available under IFRS and US GAAP to determine whether the lease is a finance lease or a operating lease. So that is what we have done. In the first, the table actually shows each of the criteria which are applied. What is the criteria under the US GAAP? What is the criteria under the relevant criteria under IFRS? And whether this terms of the lease, when this criteria is applied, whether you get a yes or no answer when you apply it to the terms of the lease. The first criteria which is applied is transfer of ownership at the end of the lease term. And this criteria is common. It's a common criteria both for IFRS and US GAAP. So this criteria, when applied to this terms of the lease, we see a no. The answer is no. This criteria doesn't apply. Second criteria we applied is, does the lease term contain a bargain purchase option? That means the lessee can acquire the leased asset at a bargain price at the end of the lease term. So we found that the unguaranteed residual value being 3,951 and the price the lessee has to pay to acquire the leased asset is 4,000 more than the bargain, more than the unguaranteed residual value. So there is no bargain purchase option. Both under, and this criteria is same criteria applies in US GAAP and IFRS. So you applied this and got the answer no. Then the third criteria we try to apply is the lease term is equal to, under US GAAP, equal to 75% or more of the economic life of the lease property, or in the under IFRS, whether it is a major part of the estimated economic life of the lease property. In both cases, we see it is 3 years out of 5 years, which neither can be considered more than 75% or a major part of the economic life of the leased asset. So the answer is both under for US GAAP and IFRS. Fourth criteria we applied is the present value of the minimum lease payments, whether equals or exceeds 90% of the fair value of the lease property, that is under US GAAP, or whether it exceeds substantially all of the fair value of the lease property. Again, we find that the present value of the MLP is only 6,682, whereas the fair value of the lease property is 10,000. So the answer is no for this criteria, both under US GAAP and IFRS. So under US GAAP, there is no other criteria. So all four criteria fails. If we apply all the four criteria, it fails. So under US GAAP, it will be considered as a operating lease, not a financial lease or a capital lease. But IFRS has got still four more criteria, four additional criteria available under IFRS. So we apply those criteria to the lease terms here and see, these four criteria were basically the leased assets are of such a specialized nature that only the lessee can use them without major modifications being made. So in this case, it doesn't apply. It's IFRS additional criteria under IFRS. Second additional criteria under IFRS is, the lessee bears the lesser's losses if the lessee cancels the lease. This term is also not available in the lease agreement. So it's a no under IFRS, this criteria doesn't apply. But the other two criteria, that the lessee absorbs the gains or losses from fluctuations in the fair value of the residual value of the leased asset, and that the lessee may extend the lease for a secondary period at a rent substantially below the market rent, both these criteria, we find the answer is yes when applied to the lease terms. So under IFRS, since two of these criteria are met, so we'll consider as a finance lease. So for the same lease agreement or same lease terms, we find that US GAAP, with US GAAP treatment, under US GAAP it will be treated as a operating lease, but under the guidelines available under IFRS, it will be treated as a finance lease. And so the accounting treatment also will differ. When it is an operating lease, the asset will be continued to be shown in the books of the lessor, the lessee will not recognize the asset in his books. So the only the lease payment rentals which are paid by the lessee will be treated as a revenue expenditure every year. So in the books of the lessee, every year operating lease expense equipment account will be debited towards 2500 and cash will be credited 2500 where lease rentals are paid. That's all. And this expenditure of operating lease expense equipment will be charged to the profit and loss account. But under IFRS where we have treating the lease as a finance lease, we have to first recognize this equipment in the statement of financial position or balance sheet of the lessee at the inception of the lease. So it will be, at what value it will be recognized? The lower of the two. One is the fair value of the leased assets and present value of the minimum lease payments. Now fair value of the leased assets we know is 10,000. And present value of the minimum lease payments of 2,500 for 3 years, discounted at the rate of 6%, is 6,680. So the lower of the two is 6,680. So this equipment or the leased assets will be recognized in the books of lessee at the inception of the lease at 6,680. So it will be reflected as an asset and also as a liability. The asset will be a fixed asset, equipment 6,680, so we'll debit equipment account 6,680 and we'll credit finance lease liability. But finance lease liability, again we'll have two components. One is the current component, other is the non-current component. That part of the finance lease liability which is payable in next 1 year, that is 2,100, although the lease rental is 2,500 in the first year, it has got two components. 400 towards finance charges, interest expenses, and 2,100 towards finance lease liability. So that component 2,100, which is payable within next 12 months, is current component of the finance lease liability. The non-current will be the remaining amount, 4,580 out of 6,680. So that is how it will be reflected in the initially at the inception of the lease in the lessee's books. And when the finance lease liability and the lease rental for the first year is paid, then we'll debit finance lease liability current with 2,100 and debit interest expense with 400 and credit cash with 2,500. So the lease payment will be recorded. Principal component is 2,100, 400 is the interest component, so it will be recorded that way. Finance liability current will be debited with 2,100. And 400 will be debited towards interest expense and bank or cash will be credited with 2,500. And we have to charge also depreciation for that equipment in the lessee's books. So depreciation will be charged on straight line method, you know. So the equipment was recognized as 6,680. So one third of that, 2,226, will be charged to the depreciation account at the end of the first year. And it will be credited to the equipment account. So this is the accounting treatment for finance lease. So you can see how different the accounting treatment would be depending on whether the lease is a finance lease or a operating lease. And this is basically the calculation to make you understand how this 7,500 or 2,500 of lease payment each year is apportioned between finance charge or interest payment and lease liability, finance lease liability. So first year 2,500, it is apportioned, 400 is the interest on 6,680 at the rate of 6,680 at the rate of 4%. So 400 is the interest, 2,100 is the principal component. So at the end of first year, the finance lease liability will be reduced to 4,580. In the second year, on this 4,580, 6% interest will be 275. So the balance of the lease payment, that is 2,500 minus 275, which is 2,225, will reduce the financial liability to 2,355. And in the third year, interest 2,355 will be 145 at the rate of 6%. So 2,500 being the lease payment, out of which 145 is the interest charge, and remaining 2,355 will reduce the financial liability to zero at the end of third year. That is what happens. Now we'll talk about sale and lease back. This is a concept very popular. Sale and lease back. This is a financing arrangement under which many leasing takes place. So what happens really? A company, let's look at this. An asset is sold, the seller sells the asset to the buyer, and from the buyer it leases back the asset. So a company has already acquired an asset. Now they want to raise, they may want to have a financing arrangement for the asset. What the seller will do is, he sells the asset to the buyer and then takes it back on lease. It's a normally a finance lease. So how the sale and lease back transaction takes place? Seller is the lessee. The seller who sells the asset is going to lease back, going to take back the asset on lease. So practically the asset is not really delivered by the seller to the buyer. On paper, the transaction will take place. The seller, as if the seller has sold the asset to the buyer who is the lessor, and then he takes it on finance lease from the buyer. It can be taken also as an operating lease, also as a finance lease, again depending on the terms of the lease. So this is called sale and lease back. This kind of transactions are quite frequent. You will come across this kind of conduct. It's a basically financing transaction. Is a sale and lease back whereby the owner of an asset sells it to a financier, who then leases the asset back to the original owner. So original owner continues to use the asset. Only thing, he sells the asset to the financier or the leasing company, and then the leasing company or the financier leases back the asset to the seller. So in the process, seller liquidates the asset and gets the money. Basically liquidates the asset, gets the money, then he again continues to use the asset by paying his rentals regularly. So analysis is actually required to determine, although most of the sale and lease back is a finance lease, but we need to analyze the terms of the lease or the commercial terms of the sale and lease back to analyze whether it should be treated as a finance lease or an operating lease. A finance lease will result in the lessee having to defer any profit on disposal over the A financial lease results in the lessee having to defer any profit on disposal over the lease term. If the lease back is an operating lease and the entire transaction is at fair value, gain or loss on disposal is recognized immediately. The difference is, if it is an operating lease, now when the seller sells the asset, he may make a gain or loss on the asset. If it is an operating lease, then the gain or loss on the asset on disposal will be recognized immediately in the same year. But if it is determined as a finance lease, then the gain or loss on disposal of the asset cannot be recognized immediately. It is to be recognized over the period of the lease term. Supposing the seller sells the asset and makes a profit of, let's say, 1 million from it, then he takes the asset back on lease under sale and lease back agreement. This profit of 1 million, question is, when he will recognize this profit? If it is a finance lease, if the terms of the lease prove that this is a finance lease, indicate to it is a finance lease, this 1 million cannot be recognized as a profit immediately. It has to be done over the period of the lease. It has to be deferred over the period of the lease. So if the period of the lease is 10 years, then over this 10 years, this profit will be recognized over the period of 10 years. But if it is an operating lease, the profit or loss can be recognized immediately in the same year when the sale took place. So that is the difference. So if we look at a sale and lease back kind of a transaction, which happens quite frequently, in many instances we come across this kind of sale and lease back transactions, it is important to understand, using those criteria under IFRS or US GAAP, to look at the commercial terms of the lease and determine whether it is an operating lease or a finance lease. Because based on whether it is operating lease or finance lease, any profit or loss on disposal or sale of that asset We have to decide whether we have to, if it is a operating lease, it can be recognized immediately. If it is a finance lease, it has to be recognized over the period of the lease terms. So, sale and leaseback is nothing but it is a, normally it's a financing transaction, basically. Normally it is used as a financing transaction. So, many organizations or many entities, if they want to basically, if they want to buy a particular asset, what they normally do? They buy the asset from the manufacturer and immediately sells it to the leasing company. First they buy the asset from the manufacturer and immediately sells it to the leasing company. Then the leasing company will lease back the asset to them so that they can continue to use the asset on lease terms. So basically, ultimately the cost of the asset is paid by the leasing company. Who pays for the asset? Actually, when you buy an asset from the manufacturer, let's say paying 5 million, what is the question from the Dhalam Shada? You are asking this question at the end of that session, difference of operating and finance lease. Okay? Operating lease is where the asset will not be, will continue to be recognized in the lessor's books. So differences are this. In an operating lease, the asset that is leased will continue to be recognized in the books of the lessor. In a finance lease, the asset that is leased will be recognized in the books of the lessor and recognized in the books of the lessee. That is the main difference. So the accounting treatment in the books of the lessor and lessee will be different if the lease is an operating lease or if the lease is a finance lease. That is the, we have gone through this example, detailed examples, how the accounting treatment for the same lease will be different in the books of the lessee if it were an operating lease or if it were a finance lease. So just now we saw an example and then you didn't raise any question. So have you understood the difference or not yet? So we talked about this difference. Under US GAAP, the lease is considered an operating lease. Under IFRS, the same lease will be considered as a finance lease. And we have shown examples of, we have shown when it is treated as an operating lease, what happens in the books of the lessee. When it is treated as a finance lease, what happens in the books of accounts or accounting treatment. So same thing. So finance lease, and see, even in this case also, in case of a sale and lease back, the difference here, not only in the accounting treatment, one more thing that I am telling is, see, here there are two transactions. See, A is the leasing company, let's look at this. A is the leasing company, it may be an NBFC. And B an airlines. Let's say B is an airlines. B has to buy an aircraft. The airlines would like to buy an aircraft. Okay. Now, B entered into a purchase agreement with Boeing. So they are buying a Boeing plane. So they purchased the Boeing plane and immediately they sold it to the plane was purchased by B, so aircraft was purchased. And then sold to the leasing company. And leasing company now leases back the aircraft to B. So ultimately, who pays for the aircraft? Tell me, who is paying for the purchase of the aircraft? The airlines company purchases the aircraft and sells it to the leasing company, and leasing company now purchases the aircraft and leases back the aircraft to the airlines company because the airlines company want to use the aircraft. Now who is actually paying the purchase price of the aircraft? Tell me, what is your understanding? Who is ultimately paying the purchase price of the asset? Yes, what's your answer? It's a very commonly used financing transaction. So who is paying for the aircraft ultimately? It is paid by the leasing company. First it was paid by the airlines and then they sold the aircraft to the leasing company. So ultimately the aircraft is paid for by the leasing company. And they are now leasing back this asset to the airlines so that the airlines, the particular airlines can use the asset. They can use the aircraft for their commercial operation. So this is an example of a sale and lease back. So this is nothing but a financing arrangement. Somebody is financing, the leasing company is financing the purchase of the asset to be used by the airlines. Is that clear? This is what is sale and lease back. It's a common mode of financing transaction. So whatever, if the be paid, let's say, 20 million for the aircraft, they sold the aircraft to A and got that money. Now in the process, B may make a profit, B may make a loss. When they're selling the asset to the leasing company, they may make a profit and they may make a loss. Now what will happen to that profit or loss? How it is to be treated? If the lease, we have to look at the terms of the lease agreement between A and B. If it is a financing lease, so the profit or loss earned in the transaction of selling will be deferred over the period of the lease. It cannot be recognized in the same year. Supposing a 1 million profit was made by B in selling the aircraft to the leasing company, that 1 million cannot be immediately recognized as a profit in that very year. It has to be recognized over the period of the lease. If the lease is for 10 years, it has to be recognized over this 10 years period. You cannot immediately recognize it as a, the full amount cannot be recognized as a profit for the first year. But if it is an operating lease, if the lease agreement, we look at the lease agreement and apply the IFRS criteria to that, if it is found that it is an operating lease, then the entire profit can be recognized in the year of sale, year of, in this particular transaction, in the year the transaction took place. So that is the difference between operating and finance lease. So you have to look at, in a sale and lease back, you have to look at whether it's an operating lease or finance lease, and accordingly, the loss on profit on disposal of the asset, whatever loss or profit has been incurred or earned due to disposal of the asset or selling of the asset, then you have to, if it is operating lease, you can recognize it immediately. If it is a finance lease, you have to recognize it over a period of time. In question, main exam question will like, I think so. So this is all about sale and lease back. So we'll last look at this exercise. An equipment is leased for 3 years. The equipment cost to the lessor is 35,000. The lessor purchased the equipment for 35,000. He has leased it for 3 years. A deposit of 2,000 is payable at the inception and is to be followed by 6 half-yearly installments of 6,500 payable in arrears, commencing at the end of the first 6 months. So first deposit of 2,000 has to be paid by the lessee, and then 6 half-yearly installment of 6,500 each payable in arrears over the 3 year period, commencing at the end of the first 6 months. The finance charges are to be allocated on the sum of digit basis. This has been classified as a finance lease. We'll have to show an extract of the financial statement of the lessee at the end of the first year. We'll handle this problem in the next session, because now we are running short of time. So maybe we'll be handling it in the next session. We'll start with this problem in the next session and then we move to the next lesson. So I will request you to submit your feedback for today's session, and your next session, as you know, will be on Friday 9 to 11. Your class sessions are now on Wednesday and Friday.